Morning.
Good morning.
How's everybody's Thanksgiving holiday been?
Great.
Thankful? Yeah. Cold weather blew in, cold virus blew in. I think several people allergies are messing them up and other people had congestion and things, and so they're playing it safe, not coming out. Thankful for that, but hope their Thanksgiving got celebrated, even though that this stuff made a hit on the end of that or something like that. But we're glad you all are here today. Hope you're glad you're here today. We're going to celebrate God and just start the Advent season. Beautiful sanctuary. Thank you everybody that participated in that and helping decorate. I'm just going to celebrate. I usually wait till after Thanksgiving to start Christmas. Anybody else do that? I know we have a lot of folks that November hits, you know, and it's Christmas time. And so, but through Thanksgiving, hope you had a great time with that. So let's lift our voices, sing to God, give him our hearts, and let his spirit just usher in, do what he wants to do.
Next Sunday, we'll try to have the Christmas card.
Oh, the Christmas cards, yeah. Real quick, let's just extend this a little bit. I know we started a little bit late. Technical difficulties, but we've been having a file system back there for Christmas cards. People bring Christmas cards and distribute them. People at church to save the postage. They donate the money for postage to the children and teens. And so we'll have that file system set up in the back for you next week. All right? Bethlehem, go ahead and... I think they're going to leave at 1 o'clock now. They pushed the time back just a little bit. But back on the information table, there is a calendar for December. With everything going on in December, it's listed all on here. And pick one up, one per household if you would. Put it on your refrigerator or your mirror, wherever you do that, to look at all the events and the things that we have going on, the caroling and those kind of things. Do you have potluck after the service today? So looking forward to that. Turkey pot pie is on the menu, I think. No, just kidding. You guys tired of turkey? Not yet? Okay, that's good. So let's have a word of prayer. We'll raise our voices to the Lord. Lord, thank you for this season that's dedicated to you. To just focus a little more directly and purposefully. As we gather together today, we lift our voices, we sing our praises to you that only you and you alone deserve. Flood our souls, fill our hearts, receive our praises. May you be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. Unto us a child is born.
redemption team. Your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I was too dear, I carry all as one. Lead me to the cross, where your love poured out. Bring me to my feet, for I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you.
You are love personified. You are
sending passion you are. You are the Lord on high. You are the way, the truth, the light. You are the Word made flesh. You are the bright morning star.
Birds of the air and the fish of the sea, everything that walks upon the land, God, the vegetation, and it all comes from you. You are the creator. We are the creation. We serve you today, God. You are the God that has no rivals, no challengers to your awesome power, your love, your greatness. For God, man devised an instrument of death called a cross, and you used that to be an instrument of life. Though it was used by man as an instrument of death to crucify, the Word made flesh. You, God, brought life out of that sacrifice, out of that death, God, to give us life to the world, made available to all. And that life, God, through your Son, that you have given us through the birth of a child. God, we celebrate you today. We celebrate the gift that you have given us in this Christmas season. May it overwhelm us even greater this year, this time of the year, to want to share that gift like we never have before. The greatest gift, the greatest story ever told, the greatest gift ever given is for us not to keep and to hold on to, God, but it's for us to share, to let it overflow. For the infinite cannot be contained in a finite vessel, God. Fill us with your infinite love. Let it pour from us onto everybody we come in contact with, everybody we interface with. Move, oh God, through us. And may your love be seen in greater measure in your church, through your church, in us. Lord, and as we gather in your house of prayer, God, we lift up Sonny Angela to you. We thank you for what you've been doing for Linda and Charles, God. We ask you to be over George and the Dave McCullough family. God, as this number of days for all of us have been written in your book since before one of them came into being, God, We trust that you would move in their home and within the family, God, to show them your glory. Give them peace through this time of transition. As we will all cross that Jordan into the promised land one day, God, that journey does not have to be with anxiety and worry, but it can be one of peace and tranquility, knowing that there is a prize waiting for each and every one of us. And as our friend and brother takes that journey, God, I just ask for you to make yourself known in all new ways. That your love, comfort, peace, hope, love, and life are present. Show yourself, God. Show your glory. We celebrate you in this time. We offer ourselves to you in greater measure during this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today marks the first Sunday of Advent, and I got to figure that out on the calendar every year. Mary texted me and said, you do know, right? And so I was counting that and those up and trying to get them together. So we have the Advent wreath, the lighting of the candles, and the reading to mark the beginning of Advent season. And you understand Advent? Everybody familiar with that? The leading up to and the preparation that the Advent season is for us to celebrate on Christmas Day. It's a wonderful time of year, and you know, people have Elf on the Shelf and those kind of things, but we prepare our hearts for that day. And as we do that through the season, we should anticipate, amen? Israel anticipated the coming of the Messiah, and then we anticipate the coming of him that we celebrate with too. So Cheryl, if you would come and read.
Good morning. First Sunday of Advent reading is hope. Isaiah 9:2-6-7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and we will be called, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Almighty God will accomplish this.
Amen.
The Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. She was growing into a teenager and was living then in the obscure village of Nazareth in Galilee. She gathered the grain during the day and tended the lamp late into the watches of the night. Her father knew the dedication of her work, her mother the kindness of her heart, her friends the charm of her smile. She stood on the threshold of womanhood. Among all the girls of the village, she had been noticed, chosen, betrothed, a child bride before whom lay only possibility. Her father could walk with pride in the city gates. Her mother could rest in the comfort of her daughter's future security. But then he came, unexpected, unannounced, spoke openly and without shame of pregnancy, virginity, and a son. Things men never discussed, and women only whispered about behind closed doors. She questioned him about the particulars, but not about the promise. She knew the prophecies, and the angel's words rang true. She'd be scorned and rejected, labeled as adulteress in whispers and glances. There would be no more carefree walks to the market, no more happy trips to the well. 400 years her people had waited for hope, but God had been silent. Now he had spoken. The wait was about to end. 40 weeks, and then Emmanuel, God with us.
Amen. Can't imagine what Mary went through on a daily basis, knowing what God had done, knowing the truth, and so many people not believing her. But when God speaks to us, and we know that we know that we know, there's something that is just cemented inside of us. And it doesn't matter what other people think, say, or believe. Because we know. And so the hope that God gives us through his Son, that we celebrate during this Christmas season, it gives us the joy, the hope, the love, everything that is in Advent. And each Sunday we celebrate one of these things. But that hope that he gave us doesn't mean it takes away all difficulties. Faith makes things possible, not easy. Amen? And so the hope that he has given us through Mary, the hope of that child, it was a difficult time for her. But believing God, yes, questioning the particulars, but not the promise. I love that statement in that video, because people question God, and he moved to say, don't doubt me. But Mary wasn't doubting, she was seeking. And so we have this hope. And this hope was not just a one time, God did something and now there's hope. Hope is for every day. Every day, no matter what we go through. And so as we go through this Christmas season, we have traditions. We talked last week about Thanksgiving traditions that we might have and Christmas traditions. We have Christmas traditions. Talked about my family for many years being a little closer to Burnet than we are here in Victoria, up there near Austin, that we would go up every year. Once we learned about that, we made that annual trek to Burnet to go to Bethlehem. And it just didn't seem like Christmas the first year we missed it. And my daughter said, well, this is just not Christmas without going. We have to go. And so we get those traditions. We form habits, don't we? Our traditions in the church can become habits, and we lose the connection that we have with God because we're just going through the motions and having that habit. But there are some good habits. There are some bad habits we need to break. We need to get rid of those, right? Habits are just things you do over and over, habitually. I mean, that's why it's called a habit, right? It's just there. There can be some things we do that are good, and there are habits worth keeping. And the hope that God gives us enables us to open up and develop these habits worth keeping. I'm going to read from Ephesians chapter 3, 14 through 19 today. It says, for this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with the power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and how high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of the fullness of God. Paul is writing this to the church in Ephesus, and he says, I kneel before God. Through which every family on heaven and earth, I mean, this, God has developed the families. It was his idea we talked about last week, and that your innermost being is strengthened, that you know that you know that you know. You don't have to doubt. Inside, your innermost being, where is your innermost being? That's the core of who you are, right? That you're strengthened, you're built up, that the power of God is there through his Spirit, is dwelling right there, making you holy. And he goes on to say, because of this, you can understand the hope that God has given you. How wide and deep his love really is. And it's infinite. We can't ever really know that, by the way. We can understand that we can't know that. And that's how deep it really is. That's what he's getting at right here. We're finite. He's infinite. That hope goes beyond our understanding. That love and power that God has, we can't grasp it. We can apprehend the fact of it. But to really know and experience that, it never runs out. And then he goes on to say that this love and knowledge of all this surpasses knowledge. He says, and when we get there, the hope is that this all comes together, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. What a blessing to ask that we are filled the measure and the fullness of God himself. Now, if that's not hope, I don't know what is. That's the hope we have. That's the hope I have. We have to involve ourselves in the habit of growing and seeking God and becoming more like him. See, we have to have the habit of constant improvement, of continuing to grow. And you say a man is supposed to lead his family. Well, if we lead our family in godliness, that means we're going somewhere. Right? We're leading. We're going. They are following us. They can't come here if I don't go here. I'm blocking this space right here, right? They're following behind. So if I'm moving toward godliness and Christ-likeness, then I'm going that, then they can come with me and follow behind, and they can grow toward Christ-likeness also. I have to move and grow toward God to be able to lead my family in moving toward him. And so then we all have to develop this habit of constant growth and improvement in godliness. God wants to perfect our personalities. He's given us a unique individual personality, each and every one of us, and I'm so glad. I look across the room right here and each and every one of you, and I appreciate each and every one of you. You are unique. Nobody else in this church is like you are. I'm thankful for each one of you. You enrich my life, and it's full because of all the different personalities and relationships that I have that are unique. But God wants to perfect it. He gave you that personality, and then this thing called sin got in there and started messing it up, taking it a different direction than God fully designed or initially designed you to have. And what we want to do is have that habit of continually bringing it back to where God planned for it to be. So we have that habit of constantly improving to perfect our personality, and that restructures all of our relationships. When our personality is brought back to where God designed it for, all our other relationships get better. And it lavishes love on God for us to want to be who he wants us to be, for us to seek and adjust and improve to what he had planned for us to be. It says it's the greatest expression of love to God when we're able to do that. It says, I believe in the hope that you've given me for my life. And that lavishing of love on God
then pours even more hope into our lives, because we see the blessing and the working, and that blessing God, I don't know how that works, by the way, that we bless God. Come on, really? The Bible says we do. When we come into alignment, we love Him back. We're pleased when people love us, and God is pleased when we love Him, and He's infinite, we're finite, He's the creator, we're the creation, and we can bless Him by doing that. So we're going to talk today about the habit worth keeping. And habit is an acronym, so we need to hear God speaking to your heart if we want to continually improve. We need to hear God speaking to us. You know, God speaks. Romans 10:17 says, so faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. The word of Christ is preached. We have to hear God first. Otherwise, we're going our own way. That's how our personalities got messed up in the first place. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own ways. God has a design. He wants to lead us and guide us. We decide for ourselves. I want this. I want that. I think this is best. And it messes with that perfect design that we had at first. And it comes in, and we have to hear the word of God to say, this is how God wants me to be. And then we look at, well, this is how I'm not like that. And there's so many people that think God's word just tells us how messed up we are and how wrong we are. And if somebody said, you know, why one of the top 10 reasons, you know, you're supposed to go to church, or why, I'm sorry, the top 10 reasons why people don't go to church. And somebody said, if I wanted to know how wrong I was, I'd just call my mom. You know, you don't just come to church to hear how wrong we are. Because God's word says there is no condemnation in Jesus Christ. So when we come, we hear His word. It's not to condemn us. It's to restore us. You know, my dad always said, you can't hear John 3:16 without hearing John 3:17. God so loved the world, you know that one? He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. For He did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but through Him the world might be saved. John 3:17. When you know, you fold that up, you see that at football games and everything, John 3:16. I wonder if somebody put John 3:17 up like that, if everybody go look that one. There's no condemnation in Jesus Christ. He didn't hang on the cross so you could be condemned. He hung on the cross so you could be restored, so you could be redeemed, so you could be bought back, so you could have life. Amen? We hear God speak to us to lift us up, not to put us down. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call to me and I will answer you. I will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. Call to me. He's telling Israel. And Israel is messing up. They're about to go into captivity. They messed up so bad. 70 years, you're going to have to learn how good I really am to you, and that I'm the one that can restore you. And He says, but call to me, and I'm going to tell you great and glorious things. Does that sound like we listen to God for Him to put us down? That sounds like we listen to God for Him to tell us great and glorious things. And He does, even if it's hard to hear. Even if it's not what we want to hear. It's for our good. It's for our benefit. It's to help us, never to condemn us. If you hear something and it condemns you and puts you down, it can be the word of God, but that spirit is not from God. If you're condemned by the word of God, you're not hearing it in the spirit of God. That's the enemy coming in and riding on that wave to try to get inside and put you down and condemn you. God's word builds up, it does not destroy. The law destroyed, the grace of Christ restores, gives life. John 8:47 says, whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reasons why you don't hear him is that you're not of God. He says, if you don't understand these, you're listening to your father, the devil. Boy, the Pharisees didn't like hearing that. You know, they were the religious rulers. They understood God, right? They knew God. They shared it. You're not doing this right. You're not doing that right. The finger would come out. God's word doesn't do that. Yes, it convicts. Yes, we can feel shame and regret, but then Christ died for that to be restored and lift us up. That godly guilt is great gain, the Bible tells us. It's not just to put us down. Conviction can make you regret that you sinned against God, so you confess it and are restored. But it's to build you up. Isaiah 30:21 says, and your ears shall hear the word behind you saying, take this way, walk in it. When you turn to the right, when you turn to the left. God leads us and guides us. He's guiding us not just so our life is good. He's guiding us so we are Christ-like. So we are a godly person. So we personify Jesus Christ to the world around us. The habit worth keeping, worth developing, worth holding on to, never to break, is to hear God. So are you truly seeking and listening to God in your life throughout the day? Do you hear? Do you sit down, open up the Word? It's okay to have that hot cup of coffee next to you when you do it early in the morning. I wake you up a little bit so your eyes start working to see the words. You just start praying. God, open my heart and my mind. Let me receive off of this page from your heart today. That I would have an understanding of what's right before me. What do you want me to hear today, God? The second thing is that we agree with him when he speaks to us. We agree with God. So we hear it and then agree. The habit, the A, is to agree. God is always right. Did you know that? Yeah. God doesn't make mistakes. I asked a couple one time that that's a beautiful story. I don't have time to tell you the whole thing, but they reached out to us. They came and sat at our table, and this girl's aunt had died, and she was despondent. And her aunt knew God, and I was trying to comfort her, and she was real close to her, almost like a mother. And I said, you know, does God make mistakes? And she kind of started to nod, yes. And I said, oh, hon, I said, God never makes mistakes. I said, God's perfect. I said, and his word says that he planned our lives out, and not the number of our days were written down in this book before one of them came into being. And we're not going to come into this world, or we're not going to exit this world before or after God has determined. And so we can trust God that whatever went on, there's a greater, higher purpose and meaning in it all. We seek that. And yes, it's hard for us to let go. Say, but God doesn't make mistakes. God is perfect. He's always right. And so when we listen and we hear and we seek him and he talks to us, the next step that we have to take is that we agree with him. We say, okay, Lord. Moses was before a burning bush, and God spoke to him through that bush, through that, out of that fire. And he said, I want you to go to Pharaoh and tell him to let my people go. And I'm going to use you to lead them out. What the first word come out of Moses' mouth to God? But God. I got a whole list of reasons why this isn't going to work out. But then we see all of a sudden, he said, okay, I'll agree with you. I'll do what you've asked me to do. With all these reasons that I can't do it. And that's exactly what God moves, isn't it? He's going to ask you to do something. He's going to lead you down a path that you're not equipped for. You can get trained. You can learn. You can grow. Absolutely. It's in the area of your giftedness and talents, and he's prepared you, but you're going to get to say, this thing's bigger than me. And God will say, that's right, let's go. And when you say yes, and you agree with him, whether it's something you need to change in your life, or whether it's something you need to go off and do, when we agree with God, life becomes anew. Luke 11:28 says, he said, blessed rather are those who hear the words of God and keep it. We hear it, we keep it, we live in it, we incorporate it into our lives. It gets infused. It's kind of like when we partake of physical food, we have to chew it and digest it. And our body takes those nutrients and it becomes a part of us. When we feed on the Word of God spiritually, we ingest it, our spirits soak it up, it gets infused, and it becomes a part of us. And now we have the strength to go and do. We have the physical strength to do because we partake of the physical food. We have the strength spiritually to do because we're partaking of the spiritual food. You know, the Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. As the parsonage is getting remodeled and the new floors went down right in front of the oven, I took a Sharpie on the concrete and I put that song, that scripture, taste and see that the Lord is good. And so now we're going to be standing on the promise of God every time we're cooking. You know, there's other scriptures along the house, so whenever you come to the parsonage, you're going to be standing on the promises of God. But we have to partake and absorb it and put it into practice. We have to agree with God is the first step to that happening. The psalmist says in Psalm 19:7-11, the law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey, and dripping of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant warned, in keeping them is great reward. Amen. You see how they brought that, the physical goodness of food into the metaphor of the spiritualness that is sweet, that is nourishing, it's desirable, it's strengthening, it's enabling, it's rewarding. Amen.
Amen.
Job says, in 9:4 says, God's wisdom is profound, his power is vast. Who has resisted him and come away unscathed? I love that verse. Maybe I just that unscathed. I don't get to say that often. God's word. We hear it. We agree with it. It helps us grow. We change. We move. How do you respond to God's word? How do you respond? Ask yourself, am I hearing God's word? Am I really seeking him? And when I hear it, how do I respond? Do I take it to heart? Am I crushed that I might have disappointed God? And now that he's showed this to me, I can receive the reward, the power, the love, the forgiveness, the strength to be different. So we hear, we agree, and then we believe. We believe that God and can will accomplish this change in our life. I can change. I can become more like Christ. I will change. I will become more like Christ. This thing in my life is not going to overcome me by the power of Christ. I'm going to overcome this thing. Little thing, big thing, it doesn't matter. God can change it. Philippians 1:6 said, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. God began the work of you being like Christ. Yes, he saved you. Boom, you're different. You're in his family. But now there's a growth that we take. We grow in grace. Become more like Christ. And God's going to continue to do this. He will continue. There's a promise we latch on to. Be confident of this. He'll finish what he started. He started a good work in you. God is going to finish it. We hear, we agree, and we believe God is going to do this. That same couple, the same friend that came and sat at my table, and she was worried about losing her aunt and what was going on in that. The husband called me one day, and he said, man, I got this thing that I've been battling, and you keep encouraging me, and I keep tripping up in it, and I came to the understanding or what I thought that I would just, as long as I'm fighting against it and I hate it and don't like it, then it's just going to be a lifelong thing. He said, God just did a work in my life, and I believe now that I don't have to fight against this thing any longer. God delivers me. He spoke to his heart. He heard his word. He agreed with God's word, and he believed that God was going to pluck it out, because God doesn't ever want you to put up with sin in your life. And he said, I feel free. Like the day I got saved, he said, I felt free. I knew I was different. He said, I feel different today. And he gave himself over to God, surrendered, died to himself, and God took that away. 2 Peter 1:4 says, by which he has granted us this precious and various promises, very great promises. Let me start again. By which he has granted us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in this world because of the sinful desires. Escaping the corruption of this world because of our sinful desires. God has given us that divine nature to indwell in us, and we can participate in that. And we believe that God is going to grow you, going to make you holy, going to purify you, going to give you desires that only please him, and that we will be cleansed and will be in right standing with God. We hear, we agree with God, and then we believe that he's the one that does it and can do it and will do it to purify us. Because God gave a sacrificial system. The wages of sin is death. And there was a sacrifice. They would lay their hands on the head of the bulls and the goats, and the sins would be transferred to the animal. The animal would have to die for those sins. And then they'd go and have to come back next year, because they kept sinning and kept sinning, because the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sin. But the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, took away sin. He died once for all. And so the sacrifice doesn't have to be made again and again and again. Because the blood of Christ purifies us. It cleanses us. It washes away our sin. It takes it away. Not just covers it up. It takes it away. And so we have this habit of hearing, agreeing, and believing. And then we have to incorporate or involve other people in our lives, in what God has done in our lives. Acts 2:42 verses 42 through 47, I think. It may say 45. I don't know if it's printed. It says 45. It should be through 47. So as they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to the fellowship and to breaking bread and to prayer, everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together, and they had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple's courts. They broke bread in their homes, and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. They did this together. They involved other people around them. They were involved in their lives. So we hear, we agree with God. We believe he can do it. And then we get involved with other people. Birds of a feather flock together. There's strength in numbers. The Bible also tells us that bad company corrupts good character. So who you hang around with is going to start developing who you are. You know, I can tell you what you're going to be like in 5 years by the books you read and by the people you hang around with. That influences you. If you're reading this book, and you're going through life together with other people that read this book, you're going to be more like Christ. If you're reading self-help books, you're hanging around people that believe in the power of oneness in themselves, then you're going to turn selfish. You won't want to be. You won't think you are, because that's not what that is about. But underlying that, it's about you. And so that's what's going to start coming out. And so we have to involve others in this habit. Involving is part of the habit. We meet together. This paragraph in Acts is the church compacted all down right here. This is the church devoting themselves. I'm going to get off all on another message right here if I'm not careful. Oh, this is it. Devoting. You know what devotion is? That's a strong word. Themselves to God's word, the apostles' teaching right here, the breaking of bread and to prayer. That was the Lord's Supper. That was communion that it's talking about. Right there, they're filled with awe because God's power is in it. When you come, where two or three are gathered in my name, I will be there also. Can you say that? They're filled with awe and wonder about who God is. The believers were together throughout this whole paragraph. They had everything in common. They sold their possessions. They met needs that people had. They broke bread in their homes. Now they're just having meals together. Coming over. I love having a membership class at my house where we share a meal. We talk, we're involved. This is the church right here as God started it. They found favor. They were together. We have to have the habit of going through life together. Holding each other up, not condemning each other, because Jesus Christ doesn't condemn you, right? There's no condemnation in him. We come together to say, hey, this is what's going on in my life and I need help. And you come along and say, I'm here to help you. I'm not here to tell you how wrong you are. I'm here to help you move right the way God's talking to your heart. Because I'm not God. I can't tell you how you're wrong. I can share with you how something doesn't match up to what God says, but it's up to you whether you do it or not. And I'm going to love you whether you do it or not. That's between you. There's freedom in letting other people have their own relationship with Jesus. They don't supposed to have your relationship with Jesus. 2 Timothy 3:16-17 says, all scripture is God-breathed, and it's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work.
We involve other people when we come together. We're supposed to encourage each other. We're supposed to exhort one another. We're supposed to rebuke one another in love. That word rebuke, people hear that as a negative thing. It doesn't have to be negative. Because encourage and exhort and restores are all positive words in here. Why is rebuking the only negative one? That's a positive word. This behavior isn't what God would have for you. I'm not condemning you. I'm not judging you. I'm saying that's not adding up to what you say you want to do. I'm sharing that. I'm letting you know. Let's go get lunch. I love you. Do with it what you will. Because love rejoices in the truth. So we hear, we agree, we believe, we incorporate others, and then we turn. And then we're transformed. In the T in this habit that we have. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Thank you. Somebody knows what I'm talking about here today. The old is gone. The new has come. We're a new creation. God does something different. He recreates us. You know, Jesus talked to Nicodemus, and he said, unless you're born again, that's new. Being born is new all over again. We're reborn in Jesus Christ. We have new life in God. It restores us. He builds us up. We're transformed. We've turned away from our selfishness and turned toward the love of God. We give ourselves away. John 13:15 says, for I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done for you. Jesus washed the disciples' feet. And he said, I've given you an example. When we're transformed and we're turned, we become selfless. We do for others. It's not all about me. My personality becomes more like Christ's. I have this hope because it's better to give than receive. And when I give, I'm filled. With hope. You feel good about yourself when you help somebody, don't you? I mean, it's right. And that's the hope that God has put in us, that flows through us, and it's washing somebody's feet, so to speak, when you help. You give a glass of water to the thirsty, a meal to the hungry. You shelter the homeless. You clothe the naked. That means we meet needs. And when we do that, it makes us more like Christ. We're transformed from love being turned inward in this world being all about us to it being turned into it's all about Jesus. And now I want to live my life, the life Christ has given me in him, the life of Christ being lived out through me to others. Matthew 13:15 says, for the people's hearts have become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. It starts with hearing. We agree, we believe, we involve and incorporate others, and it ends with being transformed. God says, I would heal them. I'll transform you. Is that a habit worth keeping? Hearing, agreeing, believing God, involving others, being transformed. I want that to be a regular part of my everyday existence. Are you continually moving toward Christ-likeness? No better time than the Christmas season. We get into the spirit of Christmas. You know, that's the spirit of more Christ. Can we combine English and Spanish together? You know, mas. I don't speak much Spanish, but I know what mas means.
know, Roberto Duran said, no mas. I mean, no more, I'm done, he quit, right? More. So if we take Christ and mas, that's Christ more. More Christ. Christmas. Bring it on. The spirit of Christmas is not warm fuzzies. Feeling good, I get presents. The spirit of Christmas is Jesus Christ. The creator of the universe, God. That's why we feel warm. That's why there's peace. That's why there's hope this time of year. That's the way the world's always supposed to be. I like that it gets greater, and I like that it lasts longer after the season. And I like that we focus on it. But let's make it our habit. Amen?
Amen.
Would you stand with me as we pray? Oh, God Almighty, speak to our hearts right now about continually moving and growing toward you, about this habit that we're supposed to have in our lives. And God, your word just opened our hearts up to see how grand it truly is. What a blessing it is. Yes, it blesses us, God, but it's not for us. It's for you. It blesses you more. And so this very hour, would you speak to us? Would we start this habit anew by hearing you right now? We're going to practice this right now, God. Speak to our hearts about anything in our life that might be hindering us from being all you want us to be. Thank you for loving us in your truth to share that with us. And Lord, as we hear you, may we agree with you that it needs to change, that you're right. Maybe I didn't know it before. Maybe I've been holding on to it. Forgive us. God, I believe you're going to take it away and you're going to change it. Tell him you believe. You receive it right now, the victory that he has waiting for you over what he just spoke to you about. Commit to sharing it with somebody else, to involve others, to incorporate other people in helping you overcome this. And God, now I receive the transformation, the healing, the deliverance that you provide through what your son did on the cross, his burial, his resurrection, ascension into heaven, the pouring out of your spirit to fill us this very hour. Thank you for the habit of being more like Christ each and every day. We stand here in the victory, who is Jesus Christ. You've nourished our souls, God. Thank you for strengthening us today. May it be infused and intertwined and woven into our spiritual fabric of alive every day, that this will just be our habit day in, day out, moment by moment. This is how we live. We thank you. We love you. We ask for you to bless the meal, to the nourishment of our physical body, so we can accomplish this spiritual task that you have for us on this earth, God. As we enjoy a king's feast at your table today, together, as the church in the first century met together and broke bread, we do today, God, to celebrate you in this Christmas season. In Jesus' precious, powerful, holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Go in his peace. Let's break bread together.